So I will talk about suffering-focused ethics and effective altruism. Here is the outline of the talk. I'm going to first explain briefly what effective altruism is. Then we're going to look at the diverse range of actions that are favored by different altruists. And we're going to look at the value differences within effective altruism, that is, the different ethical views that people have. And I'm going to focus especially on what I call suffering-focused ethics. And we're going to look at one argument in favor of suffering-focused ethics and one argument against suffering-focused ethics. And then in the end, I'm going to say a little about what we do at the Foundational Research Institute. So effective altruism is about effectively benefiting something beyond oneself. And I think of effective altruism as a mindset and behavior. And we can understand the idea by considering a few examples. So the man pictured here, Ian Ross, is a clear example of someone who is an effective altruist. But he donates more than 95% of his after-tax income. He lives in the United States, and he's very thoughtful about where to donate to accomplish the most. And we can also consider someone who would clearly not be an effective altruist. We can picture a rich person who donates a small share of her income to some readily available option, say a local sports team, and this person has not thought about whether she could accomplish more by donating somewhere else, and she's not interested in donating more. So that would not be an effective altruist. But effective altruism is not only about giving money, it's also about important choices, such as career choice and consumption choices. And so another example of an effective altruist could be someone who has made a thoughtful choice about what career to pursue. This person might not make much money, might have no money to donate, but could still accomplish a lot through her work. So effective altruists favor a very, very diverse range of actions. I'll just go through a few examples, and this is not an exhaustive list, but one common area to focus on is to help people in, especially humans in developing countries, say, curing illness and reducing global poverty. Another area is to try to protect the environment. A third area has to do with benefiting non-human animals. So it could be to try to benefit animals that are used in the animal industry, that are raised for to be food or clothing for humans. And a related area is wild animals who live in nature, who are harmed, not necessarily by humans, but it could be natural causes such as illness and starvation and predation. There are some groups who advocate for intervening in nature to help wild animals. And a fourth area is more far future focused. It has to do with preventing human extinction and ensuring that there will be a lot of positive value for many, many years ahead. And it could be not only, often a goal is that there should be many, many happy beings in the future for a long time, but it could also be that there should be a flourishing society, and perhaps great levels of knowledge and so on. And a fifth area that contrasts to the previous one is to try to reduce risks of astronomical future suffering. And this this kind of focus is not about trying to ensure that there will be many positive things in the future, but rather trying to avoid that there is a very disastrous future in the sense that many individuals would suffer extremely. So this is an area that I think is especially important, and I spend a lot of time on, and my employer, Foundational Research Institute, also prioritizes this area. So why do effective altruists have such different priorities and preferences about what to work on? Well, one reason is that they have different values, different ethical views. So
Again, this is not an exhaustive list, but I'll go through a three key distinctions that are important. So the first one is whether to care about individuals' well-being or also care about more abstract values that are not well-being. So this could be justice or equality or the environment. And what kind of values one has here could affect what priorities one makes, especially when it comes to the wild animal question, when if one cares about the sentient beings, the animals in nature, those would be the priority to help. But one could also prioritize and care about, for its own sake, holistic entities such as ecosystem integrity and species survival and biodiversity. Sometimes there are trade-offs, so you have to like pick one or the other. The second value difference is assuming we care about the well-being of individuals, which the well-being of an individual refers to how good or bad life goes for that individual. So then there's a question of, okay, so which things have well-being? Like obviously humans are widely considered to have well-being. And then many non-human animals. And then there's a question of how much moral importance to assign to humans compared to pigs or chickens or flies or all sorts of animals. And there's also a question of which animals are sentient, which animals have well-being. And that another question then becomes, so what about like machines and digital minds? Could they have well-being? And should we be concerned about them, especially if we consider the farther future and very advanced machines that might have brain-like structures? Last point in this kind of category is a panpsychism, which is a theory of consciousness according to which everything in the universe is conscious, so rocks and just matter and planets and everything. So with that kind of view, which some affected altruists hold, then that could affect your priorities because, yeah, it could be a concern that everything might potentially suffer. And so what do you then do? So, finally, I want to turn to the distinction that I think is most important, and it's the one between reducing suffering versus promoting happiness. And that's the distinction that I will focus on in the remainder of the talk. So this brings us to suffering-focused ethics, which is an umbrella phrase that I and my employer use for a wide range of ethical views that all, in practice, result in a focus on reducing suffering. So I'll take quite a few examples to explain what I mean here. And I'll explain a lot of examples of suffering-focused ethics because I want to emphasize the diversity of views that could be labeled suffering-focused. And I also want to show that there's a lot to learn here. So the first kinds of views are forms of consequentialism. And consequentialism is one of the major moral theories, and consequentialism roughly says that we should bring about the best outcomes. That's all there is to morality. And so suffering-focused versions of consequentialism include prioritarianism, which gives extra priority to those who are worse off. So if we would imagine two people, one is a person who's sick in a hospital and feeling terrible, and the other is someone who's very happy and satisfied with their life, and we could benefit these people equally much, then prioritarianism would say that we should benefit the miserable person because that would increase the value of the world more, matter more morally. So a different kind of suffering-focused consequentialism is called negative utilitarianism. And So first, to explain what utilitarianism is, it says that, okay, we should bring about the best outcomes, and the value of outcomes only depend on individuals' well-being. So not equality or justice or biodiversity or so. Only individuals' well-being. And moreover, the value of the outcome depends only on the sum of well-being. And so negative utilitarianism says that we should minimize the sum of negative well-being or of suffering. And what I just described is a strong version of negative utilitarianism. There are also like weak versions which say that both happiness and suffering matters for the value of outcomes. Both are important morally, but suffering matters more when you calculate the value of an outcome. And these theories that I've just described, they can come in a pure form. But you could also have them as part of a pluralistic moral view. So you could say, okay, insofar as the value of outcomes go, we should try to bring about the best outcomes. And say if you're a negative utilitarian, you want to minimize suffering. But there are also other parts of morality. So maybe you should never kill, and maybe you should be honest. And there are other moral rules. And such a view can overall be focused on groups and suffering in practice. And we also have non-consequentialist suffering-focused views. And just one example is a dissertation written here at Stockholm University by a professor, Ragnar Olsson, in 1979. It's called The Moral Import of Evil. And so there's a tradition of also non-consequentialist suffering-focused views. Another area is population ethics. That is a part of ethics that has to do with what are desirable population sizes, for example. How many humans should there be? And there are views in that area. One of them is called the asymmetry. And if you hold that view, you say roughly that adding someone who's happy to the world does not make the world better, but adding someone who's miserable, unhappy to the world makes the world worse. So there's an asymmetry. And if you have that kind of view, then you would probably not try to make the world better by adding more individuals or ensuring that there will be very many individuals in the future, but rather you would probably try to avoid that there will be many miserable individuals. And there are also theories of well-being that tend to result in a suffering-focused ethical view. And so one of them is called anti-frustrationism. It's about like preferences. So some people think that what's good for you is to get what you want, and what's bad for you is to if something happens to you that you don't want to happen. And this particular approach to like preferences and the value of preferences say that you getting more preferences and having them satisfied, say you want a car and you get a car, it would be equally good if you'd never had the preference in the first place. So this theory says that adding preferences to the world that are satisfied doesn't make the world better, but if you add aversions to the world that are then satisfied, so people get what they don't want to get, like an illness, then that makes the world worse. So again, this theory concludes that nothing can be better than an empty world, because there's no way to make it better by adding preferences. And there's a long tradition of similar theories, especially in Eastern philosophy, that has to do with thinking of happiness as tranquility or peace of mind rather than, say, experiencing a lot of pleasure or intense experiences. The ideal state of mind and life is peaceful and problem-free. So these theories tend to push in a suffering-focused direction. Finally, I want to mention two kinds of ethics that are related to religion or spirituality. And one is Buddhist ethics, which comes in many forms, but in general, they have a strong focus on reducing suffering. And there are also similar ideas within Christianity or Christianity-related ideas. So one example is a Polish philosopher named Tadeusz Kotabinski. In 1914, he wrote a paper called Utilitarianism and the Ethics of Pity. And so he advocates this ethics of pity, which he also calls Christianism, and that he objects to this utilitarian way of thinking of weighing suffering and happiness equally and calculating sum. Instead, he says that this ethics that he favors has been crystallized in Christian ethics, and it has a strong focus on, or some strong emphasis on, alleviating suffering and caring for those in need. So, with all these different ideas in mind, so there are many interesting arguments for and against all these ideas, and there's fairly little awareness about all these theories and all of the arguments for and against. So there's a lot of research to be done in philosophy here, and there's also a lot of education to be done to people within effective altruism and people outside of effective altruism. I will discuss one argument for suffering-focused ethics and one argument against, because I don't have more time. So the first argument for suffering-focused ethics is simply that it appropriately takes suffering seriously. And so one can illustrate this point by contrasting it, suffering-focused ethics, with traditional utilitarianism. So traditional utilitarianism is my phrase for a form of utilitarianism that assigns equal moral importance to happiness and suffering. When you calculate the value of a world, you just take the amount of happiness minus the amount of suffering. And so the best objection to traditional utilitarianism that I know of is that, according to the theory, it could be right to torture many individuals in order just to increase the happiness or pleasure of many others. And someone who is a traditional utilitarian might give various replies, but all in all, I think that's a strong objection. And an advantage of suffering-focused ethics is that such theories are not willing, or at least less willing, to make those kind of sacrifices of those who are unfortunate for the benefit of only increasing others' happiness. Now, I'll turn to one objection to suffering-focused ethics now, but I first want to emphasize that since there are so many different kinds of suffering-focused ethics, say Buddhist ethics versus prioritarianism, they probably need to be targeted with different objections. But I'll discuss one common objection, and it is that according to some forms of suffering-focused ethics, it would be right to destroy the world. Now, this objection is directed against only some of the forms of suffering-focused ethics, especially the consequentialist ones that say that we should bring about the best outcomes, and especially it's directed against forms of negative utilitarianism that are sufficiently strong. So by that I mean that the negative utilitarianism only gives weight to suffering. It says only minimize suffering. The only moral obligation we have, or at least the negative utilitarianism gives sufficiently much more weight to suffering. So, and this objection, which often comes up in conversation, when it's presented in the philosophical literature, it's about this hypothetical scenario in which a ruler has access to a doomsday weapon that could kill everyone instantly and painlessly, and the allegation then is that utilitarianism or negative utilitarianism implies that it would be right to kill everyone. But the objection is not that regular people like we here in this room would, according to negative utilitarianism, be obliged to try to create a doomsday weapon or anything like that. I'll spend quite some time on this objection, but my short reply is that if this challenge is really a problematic challenge to a moral theory like painted utilitarianism, it's not due to the suffering focus. It's due to this consequentialist idea that our only duty is to bring about the best outcomes, whatever the means necessary. And there are similar objections to traditional utilitarianism, this kind of world destruction type of change. Mm-hmm. And so, against traditional utilitarianism, the following kind of cases could or have been made. So the first one I call traditional world destruction. It says that, or the allegation is that traditional utilitarianism implies that if the future would be bad, there would be bad things ahead, then you would have an obligation to destroy the world. So it's kind of analogous. The second case is called suboptimal Earth, or that's what I call it. The allegation is that, well, according to traditional utilitarianism, if you could kill everyone and replace everyone with happier beings, then you should do so. And I've taken this and the next case from a philosopher called David Pearce. And so the last case I call suboptimal paradise, and the allegation is that, well, even if the world was a paradise and no one suffered, everyone was happy, traditional utilitarianism still implies that if you could kill everyone and replace everyone with slightly happier beings, then you should do so. And I want to look at some more examples, because you can see there's a pattern to these kind of objections to various forms of utilitarianism. So here are some cases that have been around for, some of them have been around for decades, and they're well known, but they're a smaller scale. And the first one is called transplant. It involves that a doctor sees a patient, the patient happens to have like five organs of the right, they have the right blood type, and there are five other patients who need specifically those organs, and so the allegation is that, well, according to utilitarianism, the doctor should kill this patient to harvest her organs and transplant them into other patients, and the point of this objection is that, well, that would be obviously morally wrong, so there's something problematic about utilitarianism as a theory. The second case is called Sheriff, and the allegation is that, according to utilitarianism, if a sheriff could frame and execute an innocent person to, say, prevent a riot that would cause more harm, then it would, according to utilitarianism, be the right thing to do, to frame and execute this innocent individual. And finally, the last example is called Replicas, and it involves that someone has a machine that could kill anyone and replace that person with a slightly happier replica. And the allegation is that traditional utilitarianism implies that this person should use this weapon on everyone she meets. So there are a lot of cases like this around, or this kind of objections. And there are at least five kinds of replies that utilitarians have given historically to these smaller scale cases like transplant and sharing that could also be used by negative and traditional utilitarians to the more apocalyptic objections. So, and I'll go through them briefly, and the exact content of these replies is not crucial to this talk, but I want to show that there are these kinds of replies that utilitarians have given to sheriff and transplant. And so the first one is to say that, well, in these cases, killing would not be so unpalatable because it might be less bad than the other option, or it might be less problematic than the implications of competing moral views. So. And the second kind of reply is to say that, well, these these cases in which you have some kind of doomsday weapon or all these factors come together, like these cases claim that they're so unrealistic that they don't have force as objections to a moral theory. Now, the third kind of reply is to say that in these cases, it would not be optimal to kill. So, for example, a reply that David Pearce has given in favor of negative utilitarianism is that, okay, so say that a ruler had access to this doomsday weapon, and the ruler should still not use it. It would not be the action that would minimize suffering, because it's sufficiently likely that there is suffering on other planets, and so we humans have an obligation to stick around so that we can conduct cosmic rescue missions and reduce suffering elsewhere in the universe. And so that's an empirical question, but it's a kind of reply to these kind of cases. The fourth kind of reply is to endorse an indirect form of ACT utilitarianism. I'll explain what that means. So ACT utilitarianism says that an act is right, morally right, if it brings about the best outcome, and an outcome, the value of an outcome is understood in terms of the sum of well-being or the sum of negative well-being. So, but an indirect form of ACT utilitarianism says that in general, in our lives, we should not go around trying to calculate the effects of our actions, because that will be suboptimal in the long run. So we should instead come up with these principles and guidelines for how to live our lives that will, in general, make us act optimally. So perhaps we should internalize rules and character traits so that we would be nonviolent, because that in general tends to favor good actions. And so even if it would be the optimal act in a specific case like this to, say, kill everyone, an indirect act utilitarian who thinks properly about what to do would not kill. That's the response. So, and finally, one kind of response is to formulate utilitarianism in terms of expected consequences. So, for example, a traditional utilitarian could respond to these world destruction type cases by saying that, okay, if the world in the future would be overall bad, it would actually be optimal to destroy, to kill everyone now, but we don't know that, so, and you should believe that the future will likely on the whole be positive. So according to utilitarianism phrased, traditional utilitarianism phrased in terms of expected value, then it would be wrong to kill. So my take on these kind of replies is that they are roughly as convincing if presented by a traditional utilitarian as if they are presented by a negative utilitarian. And I don't see that they are more convincing if presented by a traditional utilitarian. So I think, as I'll say here, negative and traditional utilitarianism, they are roughly in the same boat when it comes to this kind of world destruction objection. And again, they are not, these kind of world destruction arguments are not a challenge specifically for suffering-focused ethics, but for some forms of consequentialism, and that the root of the problem, if there is a problem, is not the suffering focus. So my conclusion is that in light of this world destruction objection, suffering-focused ethics is still plausible. So finally, I want to say something about, in light of this discussion about values, what we concretely do at the Foundational Research Institute. And so our basis is, or our ethical basis is, suffering-focused ethics. So, and in practice for us, this amounts to the following kind of work. So I'll describe two of our current focus areas. And so one is what we call prioritization research. So this is say that you want to reduce suffering and avoid a lot of suffering in the future, what should you do? What should you put your money to? What should you work on? What kind of policies should you advocate for? So that's an open-ended kind of strategic investigation. And a more concrete focus area for us is risks of astronomical future suffering, especially in the context of emerging technologies. So many effective altruists are worried about the potential dangers with advanced artificial intelligence. And so we are worried about that too. But our specific worry is that an AI will act in a manner that will then result in a future that's much, much worse than the current world. So we're looking for ways to avoid those kind of worst case scenarios. So for example, we're looking at if a very advanced artificial intelligence would be created and it would fail, so it, say, kills all humans, then what? What happens? There's a wide range of scenarios that could occur, and some are much worse than others. So we try to see if an AI is constructed and fails, could we make it so that as a plan B, things doesn't get as bad as they could potentially get. So I'll end with saying something about how to get in touch with us and myself and how to stay in touch. So I've listed here some contact information for the Foundational Research Institute. We are, for example, hiring for various positions. We're looking for researchers, and then often like a promising indicator of a good applicant is that they have a technical background in because we're so focused on technologies and artificial intelligence, and so a background in computer programming or computer science, mathematics, physics, and so on is an indicator of a promising applicant, although we welcome applicants from all backgrounds. And there are ways to follow our work on Facebook. I also list the contact information for the Effective Altruism Foundation, which is the parent organization for the Foundational Research Institute, and they might also be interested in volunteers and staff. And finally, I'll list the information for myself. If you want to follow my work, or feel free to get in touch if you have any questions or thoughts after this meeting tonight. Thank you.
So now it's time for questions. You can ask questions in either Swedish or English. If they are in Swedish, perhaps you could read our Swedish somewhere. Like I think you perhaps can direct who gets to ask the question.
Okay, sure.
Well, as you said, these world destruction arguments don't... Jag tar det på svenska.
Ja.
Nej, men de här argumenten riktar sig mer åt konsekvensialism snarare än åt lidande fokus. Men hur ska man tänka på lidande på ett icke-konsekvensialism? Eller jag vet inte om det är det du föreslår att man ska göra.
So, the question, I'll repeat it in English. So, the question is, this world destruction objection, kind of objections that I claim are more properly directed, or the cause of the problem is consequentialism and not the focus on reducing suffering. And so if one rejects a consequentialist ethical view, how should one then think about reducing suffering? So I would not describe myself as a consequentialist. And I think, so a part of the attraction and also problems with consequentialism and utilitarianism is that it's very simple. So morality reduces to one principle, to bring about the best outcome, so maximize the sum of happiness or something like that. And so as long as you have any other principle beyond that, you are no longer in the realm of pure consequentialism. So myself, I'm kind of attracted to have these ideas about like decency and honesty and nonviolence and compassion and all the, like I try to develop those character traits, but then one can also care a lot about the value of outcomes and the amounts of suffering and so on. So I would, yeah, some kind of pluralism is what I would find attractive.
So in my opinion, or in my view, effective altruism comes across as a very radical theory, but then when you introduce the value of pluralism into that, it becomes very, very much less radical. So the question is, how do you balance those, and how far do you go with your values towards the desired outcome? Because that's, if we add value and decency to all those examples, they become less more powerful, for example, or consequences.
So, yeah, you mean to the world destruction type of cases. Like, yeah, they're obviously not applicable to a moral view that says, you know, never kill. You wouldn't kill everyone. So, and I think, so much of like the basic ideas that have, that were around before there was even a term or phrase called effective altruism, this idea that, well, assuming at least a part of your morality is about trying to benefit something beyond yourself, you could use a scientific method to understand what works, and you could try to be more ambitious, like sacrifice more of your own earnings, and you could be ambitious in the sense of not being just satisfied with doing some good, or you know, having some impact, but trying to improve and improve. So with that kind of general idea of effective altruism, that's very non-radical, right? Even, although some would object and say that if I chose to work for, to benefit something, there's no wrong with that, because even if I could do better, I just want to do this. So it's still somewhat substantial, but yeah, not radical. It sounded like you thought, you think effective altruism is commonly understood as having a consequentialist or utilitarian foundation. Was that correct?
Oh, like beslutsmetoden.
Yeah, the decision method?
Yeah.
Yeah, so again, so I could say, without being a consequentialist, that when it comes to my donations to animal charities that try to promote veganism or so, I care about the number of chickens and the number of fish and the number of cows, and so I favor, since there are many more fish, I favor actions that help fish and so on. But one doesn't need to be a consequentialist to say that. Yeah.
But if effective altruism is not focused on consequentialism, is it focused on virtue ethics?
So the point of my talk here has been to show the diverse range of priorities within effective altruism and the diverse range of different values or ethical views people have. So I wouldn't say that, no, I would not say that effective altruism is focused on virtue ethics or so. But my point is more that you could find virtue ethics attractive and still be an effective altruist, or still want to, you could say that it's a virtue to try to be analytical about when you try to benefit others. So that's a kind of, yeah, did that answer?
Your ambitions and aspirations for this Foundation Research Institute, is it just about learning about it, or just going to a political thing to really make a difference? And with this whole AI astronomical threats, and are you collaborating with some other institutes that are focused on the same?
Yeah. So yes, we have talked to policymakers, and we especially the parent company, Effective Altruism Foundation, publishes like policy papers and holds like press conferences or press releases, and we are in touch with other organizations who work on artificial intelligence and similar risks, and we're so that's one justification for the existence of this kind of independent research organization, is that you could do a more applied work than what you could do at a university, because you might look at, say, some backup system for an AI, such that if it fails less badly, and you can investigate that. Maybe you would not be welcome at a university to do that, but given that our donors find it important enough, then you can do that kind of work here. So we definitely want to have a practical impact. That's the whole point.
A question about financing. Do you get your financing from entirely from governments, or is it like companies? And if so, are these companies interested in like?
It's just from private individuals.
Oh, it's just from private individuals. So it's like private interests that donate money to this institute.
In the sense of like people like us in this room.
Yeah.
Like if you go to some big charity, there's a donate button, yeah, and you can send in money. So there are. I mean, if you think about human rights organizations, they probably do a lot of office work and reviewing documents and so on, and they are paid by people who want to contribute to their mission. And so, as far as I know, it's the same here.
Thank you.
Are you based here in the, like, do you have offices here as well, or are you based only in America?
So the parent organization, Effective Altruism Foundation, is based in Berlin. It originated in Switzerland, but it's kind of moved to Berlin. So the official address of Foundational Research Institute is in Switzerland, but most of the staff are in Berlin. So I stayed in Gothenburg, Sweden, and we have our like research lead person is in New York, U.S. So I work like remotely from Gothenburg.
Hmm. Cool. So if one wanted to get involved, what would that look like?
Yeah. So it says on the website that remote work is possible. We have researchers in across the world. So you could do a lot of work remotely. We have one staff in Finland. It would probably involve a little bit of travel sometimes to Berlin to meet your colleagues. It would involve some Skype calls or online conference calls. And you might want to travel to conferences or give talks or so. But the research work could be done almost anywhere.
Brilliant, thanks.
Yeah.
So, like, the argument for why you say, or do you seem to favor negative utilitarianism?
No, because, I don't think of myself as a consequentialist, and negative utilitarianism is a form of consequentialism. So, I wouldn't say that that's the best theory, and the one I like the most, or so, but I think a suffering-focused ethics, some version of it, is very attractive. And if you would compare traditional utilitarianism with negative utilitarianism, then I would say that negative is more reasonable.
Okay, but the argument for why negative utilitarianism is more preferable is this torture example, right?
But the
hidden premise within that is that it's wrong to make other sufferers to promote the happiness of, to promote the sort of total well-being and happiness.
Yeah.
But that seems to me to give like the outcome that inducing pain in the world is like what we should focus on or reducing. Like we shouldn't induce pain. That is something that is like a vicious decision to do. But the flip side of that sort of then becomes that decision making, which is like focused on like, which has a promotes happiness but also promotes pain in some way to other agents.
Yeah.
It's like then wrong decision. But that sort of decision making seems to be like the foundation of like a modern society. And so like every decision making has, like in the political sphere, has to do this like calculus between pain and happiness. And that sort of seems to lead to this, you know, negative rights ethics. It sort of like falls into that, right? Or am I mistaken?
Okay, so two replies. The first is that the objection that I pointed to traditional utilitarianism is that it could be right to torture many to just increase the happiness of many others. And if we consider this like concretely, like torturing people for a whole lifetime just to benefit hedge fund managers who want even better food and so on, that would be morally like outrageous. And so that's a problem for. And you could vary that objection so it becomes more realistic. Like maybe you have to take some risks of some other people suffering in order to benefit some other people's happiness. And as of many such cases, I think would amount to that traditional utilitarianism has an impossible implication. But then there's the question of, okay, so should we, when making decisions, never trade off any, say, in policy making, if we expect some, say, cultural building or an amusement park to be benefit the enjoyment of many, many children and parents, but it would increase the risk of one death in some attraction.
I mean, not just that. Like, let's say there's an apartment building next to the amusement park. Like, two people there have like traumatic experiences regarding amusement parks, so they get triggered by the fact that it's there, and like they suffer quite immensely.
Yeah.
Of this, right?
So, I mean, again, if you have a weak negative utilitarianism, you would give moral weight to both happiness and suffering. So you would trade them off, but you would have more weight to the suffering. So there would need to be more to counterbalance it. So that would still allow a form of the decision making that you seem to favor, but also a strong negative utilitarian who says, you know, only minimize suffering, could reply that what the kind of decisions that we do in society should actually be about minimizing suffering. You should never do a policy in which you hope to just increase the enjoyment of some people at the expense of someone else's suffering. But you should try to see how can we minimize depression, accidents, whatever kinds of harms there are in society. So did that answer?
Yeah, I guess so. I guess in fact the principle becomes a kind of weird way. So, because it seems like there's always calculus in the trade-off.
Yeah, so again, a strong negative utilitarian might say, so yes, in policy decisions, you have trade-offs. Some policy benefits someone, and it has a negative effect on someone else, and you have to kind of try to balance out, is this a good policy or not? And but the negative utilitarian would say that, or the strong negative utilitarian would say that, okay, but when we look at these, we still need to do all these trade-offs, but it's the trade-off is between someone's suffering and someone else's. So we try to just minimize the suffering. So, yes, you would still do the, you might say that, okay, but that decision procedure would lead to absurd conclusions or so, but it's not obvious that it would, at least to me. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Maybe.
So, don't take this as a personal challenge, but let's assume I'm a very dedicated effective altruist and I'm suffering focused.
Yeah.
Why should I give money to your foundation rather than money to give people in Africa malaria nets or mosquito nets?
Yeah. So it's, of course, it's hard to quantify where you go, especially when you have more research-oriented work that's less concrete. But we are the only organization that I know of who has this suffering-focused approach. So if you agree with those values and also agree with the big risks in the future, there is, as far as I know, no one else who works on suffering-focused AI safety. And so, yeah, if you want to fund that, you might have no other option. We've been described as by someone as the most important think tank in the world. So that's a quote.
Should insert it there.
Sorry?
You should insert it there.
Yeah, do you do any sort of anti-terraforming campaigning, awareness raising, that kind of thing?
So where do we do any anti-terraforming campaign? So terraforming means to try to change other planets so that they become habitable to humans. So you might want to change their whole atmosphere and so on so that it starts growing forests on a planet that was previously just barren, empty. So no, that's not a priority area in one sense, but indirectly, there is a worry that future individuals or an artificial intelligence might want to colonize space. And there are individuals who want to send out organic material in all directions in space and hope that it lands somewhere so that it takes and becomes a new ecosystem and spreads life. So that's like one worry. And I have a colleague, Brian Tomasik, who's written about how, so he's opposed to that, but it's not something that we are lobbying for or actively spending resources on.
Well, why not, may I ask? I mean, since it's pretty high up on Brian's list of.
Yeah, I think it falls more broadly under, it's one thing that could go wrong, but the risk is more disasters in the future in terms of vast amounts of extreme suffering, and the most likely way that that would happen is not that humans try to terraform our neighboring part of the universe, but more, very powerful artificial intelligence does something else, or does that as a small part of what it does.
Okay. So I'm just saying this must be the last question because
okay.
Then we're.
Oh my! Okay, no pressure. I guess my question is I think this focus on like having a robust like moral theory or like making sure that like the thing you try and do to like improve the world. It's like a really robust thing, so like you're pretty sure that it's going to be good from a lot of perspectives. I think that's a really good approach to have, and like is an approach that like a lot of people in effective altruism talk about. That like helping a person like not have malaria is a good thing, like based on loads of theories.
Yeah.
And the thing I worry about, like especially with your work, is like are we straying too far away from that in some cases? It seems to me that like once you get to the point where you try and once you get to the kind of work that you do, you've like gone quite far down like the rabbit hole or whatever. You've made like quite a few like assumptions about like ethics, etc. That like might be questionable, and that maybe you want to go for more like robust ways to improve the world.
Yeah. Okay. So there are two senses of robust, right? One is. Even if you would be completely certain about that you have the right moral theory, it's desirable to do things that also others think are good.
Yeah.
Even if you're certain that they're wrong, their values. So, but then there's a sense of robust in that you try to rely on as uncontroversial moral ideas as possible, and you try to. Yeah, it would be unfortunate if you took a lot of actions in one direction and then you realize that, oops, that was based on dubious moral theoretical assumptions, and so now I regret that. So regarding the first sense and kind of concern for others' values. That's one part. Either it's our mission statement or our about paper, so that we try to find like, collaborative approaches. So we look at, and we've written about like compromise and being nice to people with other values and so on. So we try to look at things that are good from a lot of perspectives. So this, for example, this work of ours to prevent disastrous future scenarios in the sense of outcomes that involve many beings suffering terribly, that's something that everyone wants to avoid. And then we have, when we are willing to take, like, when we have trade-offs and what we then want to focus on more exactly, we have a specific approach to that and so on. But so I think we try to be collaborative in that first sense. And then maybe what you meant was more the second sense, in that this relies on many controversial assumptions, this work. So I think this is one of the most basic or most widely held moral ideas about the importance of helping those who are badly off. And it's in population ethics, it's like there's a lot of debate about whether do you actually have an obligation to bring people into the world, to have children, for example. Does that really make the world better? But it's much less controversial to claim that, well, if you bring someone into the world who will just suffer and suffer, that's you shouldn't do that, and that's a bad thing. So this, yeah, I think of it as one of the most robust ideas there are in that, you know, if you can at least prevent extreme suffering, then it's, you've done something.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.